So at the bottommost depths of the Great Depression, and the Great Depression, of course, lasted from 1929 to 1939, basically. At the bottommost depths, which is from 1933 to 1935, America began to look as trashy and as cheap as its ideals of free enterprise and democracy were said now to be. In a place like Skid Row in Los Angeles, a name that has become kind of famous for urban squalor, we already have, by the depression of the 1930s, people using sidewalks as kind of halfway houses to stay. Thousands of homeless people piling up. This was the time of the Great Dust Bowl. We sometimes call it also the Dirty 30s. The Depression, the greatest environmental disaster in our history. If you remember the word 100, you can use it twice. Beyond the 100th meridian, basically, that is on the road to Lubbock. If you go west of there, where the ecosystem is especially fragile, you have 100 million acres blowing up into the sky. And even coming down in places like New York City and Washington, D.C. That's why it's the greatest environmental disaster. About 3 million people are displaced. Does anyone know anything else that occurred during this? I mean, what happens when a big, dark, black cloud settles over your neighborhood? It's like all blue dirt. Of course, Lubbock, if you live in Lubbock, you can... Not as dirt gets in the air as it is, but nothing like this, though. But if you have a huge, black dust cloud that just settles... Well, it creates a tremendous amount of static. And like if Richard and I would shake hands, we would actually get, like, get a shock. I mean, jackrabbits were actually electrocuted to death. It plays terrible havoc with any green thing. In Cinnamon County, Oklahoma, it was said that all the green grass died. I mean, there's nothing green in the whole county. We had cows giving chocolate milk because they were ingesting so much dust. Thousands of children and babies dying because of dust pneumonia. We gum up the keyhole to your door, but still, the sand would just come in waves. You just couldn't keep it out of your house during this dust bowl. And you know what causes terrible things? So basically, people overplanning and not anticipating drought-like conditions beyond the 100th meridian, tearing up all the soil, hoping they get a bonanza crop, but instead they get the dust bowl. So we've got, you know, people that are out of work, 17%. Hanging out in places like Skid Row. We've got the Dust Bowl of the 1930s, the portent of the Book of Revelation where the sun turns red. This is what happens in a Dust Bowl. We have places like Wisconsin and Minnesota, which one journalist said looked like Siberia, where the cattle were forced to eat brambles because the farmers weren't growing enough hay and corn. They didn't really have incentives to do it. The prices were falling down so low. And then in our area, we've got the terrible scourge of the boll weevil, that has taken out the cotton crop. And one reason why the East Texas cotton crop, which was one time a big deal around here, goes entirely to West Texas is because of this beetle. We've never really been able to deal with the beetle, the boll weevil, changing the whole economy of our area. So, these are huge threats, and the question was, we're definitely going to be, you know, since we're going to have some change, who's going to get the power to control that change? And will the people in charge create good reforms that will help our society, or will they create desperate reforms and try to cure the economy that will leave the society with a legacy of problems? So I hope again today that you can kind of see that this is going to be the rise of big government, big liberalism in the 1930s. And if you are a libertarian conservative, you're going to have problems with a lot of these programs. If you're a liberal who believes that government can create the golden pathway to a better society, you're going to look more tolerantly at what goes on during this 1930s period. If you're a more conservative, you know, Republican who likes the government we have but don't want more, kind of like George Bush or something like that, you'll probably be kind of sitting on the fence on a lot of the stuff that occurs in the 1930s. But I hope you can kind of see it, that how this matters to you and how, you know, you vote really hinges, because modern America is based on this foundation stone of this rise of big government. What do you think about it? The liberal state of the 1930s. Well, of course, we don't at first get really the government. Instead, we get Herbert Hoover. And Herbert Hoover is, of course, more of a conservative Republican. He's not a total libertarian, though. He does do some things to try to cure the Great Depression. Does anyone remember what did Herbert Hoover try to do? I think kind of in class, with a fedora hat. And anyone remember what did Herbert Hoover try to do? He tried to keep money in the economy by having a Hawley Smoot tariff, an average surcharge of 29% on all incoming goods, so we wouldn't buy foreign goods. With the Federal Reconstruction Corporation, he tries to loan money out to civic municipalities at very low interest rates to kind of get them out of the red. So he tries, you know, a few things with loans, and yet the economy does this plummeting, you know, 1929 to 1932. Hoover, nevertheless, is resolute, and in one of his addresses, he says amidst, you know, the rising concern that, you know, people are saying in the ballgames, "We want bread! We want bread!" And they're calling, you know, places where the homeless are living Hoovervilles, and they're holding up signs on roadways, "If you don't pick me up, I'll vote for Hoover." You know, "This is a Hoover flag, you know, not having anything in your pocket." Hoover flag. Nevertheless, he remains resolute, and he says, "We don't want the claptrap of the Russian or French Revolution. It is not in frozen securities that we are losing, but in frozen attitudes. We Americans must rediscover the meaning of the word liberty. Liberty is not a set of rights. It is self-reliance, honed on the grindstone of competition. With liberty, Americans have a tradition all their own and a message that can save the world." This was a traditionalist American assumption that we should let, you know, people compete. And so this was a contraction. People pull themselves up by their bootstraps, they become more competitive, they become more innovative, and sooner or later we're going to get out of this contraction. One of the great funny things, though, about this 30s, and it seems to be some sort of mass psychology involved, is even though the Republicans try things, the Democrats try things, we are in this depression for 10 years. And all kinds of competing answers, why it says. In any case, Hoover doesn't really reverse the situation. And as we see, by 1932, people are starting to gravitate more and more in favor of this magic Roosevelt name, you know, the promise of the charisma that we talked about with Teddy. Only now it's a different Roosevelt, since the first one is dead. This is his distant cousin, Franklin Roosevelt. Born in the upper class circles in Orange County, New York, in 1882. He's kind of a brash young man, kind of like in the Rooseveltian tradition. We remember Teddy comes first. Teddy's a teddy bear. Teachers are more frank with you as you get older. Thus, Franklin is the second Roosevelt, Franklin. And Franklin Roosevelt, I think, can best be described as a small-s socialist. That is, he wasn't a big S socialist. He wasn't an ideologue in any way. But he was a true liberal in that he was a people person. He saw his redemption in the social. To be around breathing, laughing, curious flesh, this for him was enough. Now, he was an Episcopalian, but you know, he really liked to golf with his buddies on Sunday morning rather than going to church. I think one of the most revealing comments that he ever made was when a reporter asked him, kind of off the cuff, "Mr. Roosevelt, what was the worst moment of your life?" And he said, "The worst moment in my life was when I failed to become a member of Harvard's Parcellian Club." Four of his children became drunks. Four of his sons became drunks. You know, he experienced World War I, World War II, and all that fallout. And his biggest problem is that he never was a member of Harvard's Parcellian Club. But this is a guy who really liked to be with the group and wanted to be thought of as one of the group. After he gets elected, he's the only president elected four times. He loved being president, and or at least had to be. Part of his being, you know, just had to be president. He had two very sheltering parents, by the way, Sarah and James, who kind of kept him away from France, and this may explain why he needed to be around people. But, you know, by 1944, this guy has all sorts of mental problems. He can't even pour his cream in his coffee. Like, he's pouring the cream all over the table, and yet he's running for president a fourth time because he just cannot say no to being, you know, in the center of things. Well, as a young man, he was a very attractive Adonis who had all kinds of girlfriends. The question might be, why did he settle all women on Eleanor, his distant cousin, who had a kind of toothy smile and kind of upswept nose, but even wasn't the most attractive woman that he had courted. Indeed, even Eleanor's mother is reputed to have said it about her when she was about the age of 20. Eleanor, when are you going to stop looking like an old maid? Well, Eleanor did have some attractive qualities that Franklin honed in on. She was a much more focused person, kind of like Bill and Hillary Clinton, where Bill was a schmoozer and the people person. Hillary had focus. This was certainly Eleanor. You know, she stuck to deadlines and schedules and budget amounts and things like that. But also, I think the real thing that sold Franklin on Eleanor was that she was the favorite niece of Teddy Roosevelt. Now, Franklin is a distant cousin. He adores Teddy, even though he's a Democrat, Franklin is, and Teddy's a Republican. In fact, Franklin one time says, as a kind of rash young man, I'm going to be just like my cousin Teddy. I'm going to be Assistant Secretary of the Navy, I'm going to be Governor of New York, and I'm going to become President of the United States. And he was actually right about all three of those things. So it seems like by marrying Eleanor, who was the favorite niece of Teddy, it was a kind of a lure, you know, that he would be in with Teddy. He'd be more, you know, even though he was kind of a distant cousin. You know, the Teddy Roosevelt, who was actually from New York City, Long Island area, his Roosevelt clan was like way up in the Hudson River area. So it was kind of to unite him more with the Teddy group. And indeed, Teddy Roosevelt shows up to the wedding. He showed up to a pre-wedding event where he threw Eleanor in the pool, even though she had, you know, nice clothes on, you know, figures. Franklin, though, soon, you know, paid for this dalliance. They have four children, as we noted. You know, Teddy Roosevelt's sons get killed in war, and Franklin the Schmoozer's sons all become alcoholic. Both Franklin and Eleanor would start blaming one another on this. But one of the problems, real problems, of course, with Franklin was that Eleanor wasn't the kind of party guy that he was, and was perhaps going to be inevitable, but a guy that didn't take his religion all that seriously, and who really loved to be around women, and really found his, you know, his niche in being around women who would laugh at him, that he would soon give up on the rather stern, stentorian Eleanor. But in any case, Eleanor one summer decides that she's going to leave Washington, D.C. when he became Assistant Secretary of the Navy with the boys because, you know, it's kind of an oppressive, muggy environment before air conditioners. She's going to go up to Campobello, their family estate right by the Atlantic. And she leaves Franklin in Washington. Now, tragically, she left him with her social secretary. This time, other women would take care of their schedules, Lucy Page Mercer. And Lucy Mercer was also a very sheltered woman. In fact, she had gone to a convent school. Her parents had been very wealthy, but then they became busted, and she had to become a social secretary. So here she is, a social secretary to Eleanor, and Eleanor is leaving. She had been guarded all her life, and there's Franklin. And he really recognizes that Lucy is not only very attractive, but she's very capable, and he starts employing her for some things with the Navy Department. They start working late into the day, and pretty soon they're working over dinner hour, and pretty soon they're working later into the night, and sometimes they're not even working. With all this overwork, Franklin Roosevelt gets a bad case of sickness, and Eleanor starts reading his mail, and she finds out the terrible truth of this affair. And this is one thing that Franklin's mother, Sarah, also got very upset with Franklin. Up until this point, Eleanor's biggest cross was her mother-in-law. Sarah bought their home, Sarah controlled their lives. One reason why maybe the boys became drunks is because their grandmother said they could do anything. Because Sarah owned their homes, what could Eleanor say? But now, Sarah, the mother, starts really getting on Franklin, having cheated on his wife and family in this way. And so finally, Eleanor has that problem. But basically, She threatens a divorce, but Franklin begs her to stay with him. And what he says is he'll never see Lucy again. Lie. He does at least keep her out of Eleanor's sight pretty well. But also that they will kind of remain this kind of armed truce together. And she'll be able to say a lot more things in his political career. So she becomes kind of like a queen in chess. She can go anywhere. Franklin can never really, you know, totally get rid of Eleanor. Although after he becomes president, they are never in the same room together. Well, as it happens, Roosevelt has another major turning point. In 1921, after he ran unsuccessfully as vice president, wakes up one night feeling all these needles and pins and fire in his limbs, and he's got a terrible case of polio. And he starts crawling around on the family rug, and he trembles with exhaustion, his face turns beet red. The doctors shake their heads, you know, he'll never be able to walk again. He really will have to get out of politics. Surprising how some bad things can turn out in unexpected ways. Roosevelt still has this inner drive, but somehow he can do it, even though he's lost feeling below his waist. We never, of course, had a cripple before this as a president, although we do have a cripple right now as a governor. Does anyone know what happened to Greg Abbott, our governor? He was jogging in Houston, and a tree fell on him.
Oh, wow.
And that left him crippled for life. And one of our local lawyers.
Was that recently or no?
No, it was earlier in his career.
Did he sue? Or you can't sue?
Yes, he did sue. And that's one of our Mount Pleasant lawyers who I was talking to about this. You know, he says, "No, that Greg Evans, he's such a big hypocrite." You know, because he sued big time after he was hit with his branch. But since he's been governor, he's been for tort reform and for limiting the amount of damages you can get, you know, from lawyers.
Wow.
So Franklin becomes crippled. However, because he's crippled, he has to use a lot. He's crawling around constantly. He's working out with his upper body strength. And actually, this helps him, because if he uses leg braces, which he does, so it makes it seem to the American people like he can actually walk, but he can't. When he accepted the Democratic nomination for president of the Democratic Party in 1932, he had two people on either side of him. They kind of like go down to the podium with two guys on center. They can't even tell that he, you know, can't even walk. He so builds up his upper body that he looks magnificent. You know, once you launch this guy on the podium and get him up there, you know, he has a very mellifluous, you know, big voice. And because he's been working out his upper body, so his upper body actually grows in inches because he's crippled and he's working out. Of course, he's still, you know, anxious to meet with women. He's a very socialite creature. He actually finds a woman of partial Irish Huguenot descent, Missy Lehan, who becomes kind of like his personal secretary. And sometimes he likes to go out on boat rides and kind of get out of the claustrophobia. And she actually goes with him on these boat rides. They become very close. Later on, though, Roosevelt will go back to Lucy, and Missy Lehan will have a nervous breakdown. Imagine, say, going out with a crippled guy and he kind of leaves you for another woman. So the White House is really kind of a strange amalgam of people walking in and out. Eleanor and Franklin aren't in the same bedroom, but Eleanor has another woman journalist, Lorena Hickok, and they write a lot of warm, passionate letters to one another. It seems that this was another kind of lesbian Jane Addams type thing, probably they didn't call it at the time. And then you have Harry Hopkins showing up, a former social worker from Grinnell, Iowa, who talks so big about helping people that Roosevelt just kind of invites him in the house. And he's got a daughter that Eleanor likes, because Eleanor never had a daughter. So he just kind of, you know, comes in one night for dinner and stays. That's it. So the White House is kind of like this strange amalgam of all these kind of people coming and going. And it's kind of symbolic of Franklin Roosevelt's New Deal and his government, his big government, because he's a social-minded person. He's not an ideologue. He just invites all these people in, you know, "Sure, Harry, you want to try out this idea? This sounds great. Most people will also attest that after he became crippled, he actually became a more gracious person. So if Missy would mess up a little bit, "Missy, will you please try to get these files straight? I'll never..." That kind of come and change to, "Oh, Missy, you goosey girl." So he becomes a lot more sunny, Pollyanna type person. Maybe this was kind of like his log cabin because he was born so wealthy. Now he had something that people could kind of sympathize with. And because, if you're in a wheelchair, you can't always put out your cigarette, he develops this kind of trademark of cigarette holder. And because, if you have a two-year-old and you're getting him out, I don't know if your niece is like this, when she was younger, when you try to get her out of a car, you have to change her coat. So he starts wearing this navy cape that becomes kind of a trademark because it was kind of hard to get him changed all the time. So he develops a kind of persona, even though he's crippled, and it's actually, in many ways, to his advantage. So he's got this magic name. He gets elected. Hoover only carries Maine and Vermont in the 1932 election. But he immediately jumps into a catastrophe that is occurring. Now, I'm not talking about the Dust Bowl. I'm not talking about the 17% unemployment that averages out through the 1930s. What other big apocalyptic, tragic type developing situation is occurring at this time? Don't we have enough that's bad to talk about? When Roosevelt's immediately elected, what's the big deal that he's going to concern himself with? It's a financial meltdown. The banks are failing. When the Florida banks failed in December of 1932, you could say, well, it was the Florida land boom, and those banks had gotten a little frisky. But when the New York banks are going in January of 1933, just as Roosevelt's, getting the baton to become president, this is really serious. So what does Roosevelt do? Roosevelt declares a bank holiday. He starts a new government agency called the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, FDIC. Remember, we already had the Federal Reserve. Government was already involved in the Great Depression in a big way. The Federal Reserve had lent out too much money in the 20s. It let speculate in the stock market. Then the Federal Reserve became really panicky and they started withdrawing all this money. And some conservative economists said that's the reason why we never got out of the Great Depression, because there was not enough money around. So big government was already involved in this depression. But now we've got, in addition to the Federal Reserve, we've got the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, which even today is supposed to secure your savings deposits. So generally, the banks that you go to around here, American National, Guaranty, whatever, will definitely say FDIC institution. It all goes back to 1933 when Roosevelt starts this new agency. But still, he had to worry about the psychology of the people. He declares a bank holiday. He institutes the FDIC with Congress's support. But what if the people still run on the banks? Are you going to trust your bank to remain solvent, or are you going to get your money and take it out? Well, one asset about Franklin Roosevelt is he does have a very charming, manly, heartwarming, musical type voice. And he gets on the radio, which was the great instrument of that time, and he says to millions of Americans, "The bank holiday is affording us an opportunity to secure your deposits. No bank is going to be a dollar worse off than before it closed its doors. When the banks reopen, I can assure you, it will be safer for you to keep your money in a reopened bank than to stuff it under the mattress." But would Americans heed this address, this fireside chat as they were called? Would they really stop to run the bank? Yes, they did. So chalk up one for liberals who believe in government. Here was a good, really good illustration that FDR was a kind of savior for the time being. Of course, it could be argued that a big government can solve problems smaller than itself, but can it solve the big, big issue like the Great Depression itself, which this was only one manifestation of. We saw in 2008, both Bush and then Barack, they think too, they gotta help the banks in some way. And maybe that did stave off. The Goldman Sachs got this big relief from the government. people around here, the small banks around here, they hate this. You know, too big to fail. And Cyprus Bank people, American National Bank people, they're saying, why does the government help out these big banks and not us? That seems unfair. So there's been a lot of, you know, interplay there. But in any case, Roosevelt, the New Deal wins. And this is what allows then Roosevelt to go hog wild, in a sense, in the buildup of big government, because immediately after coming into office, he seems so un-Hooverish. You know, it seems like he's solving something. He solved the bank crisis. If we'd had that financial meltdown, who knows where it would have ended. You know, not to have any banking institutions and people just, you know, bartering and using money outside of banks. What we then have is Franklin and a bunch of buddies just trying all kinds of stuff, like a kind of homeopathic pill. Sure, let's try it. And basically, the New Deal then stands for a set of new government acts that try to better the economy. And they try to better the economy through providing direct relief, what we call welfare today, direct handouts, relief. They try recovery, that is, they try to get some groups on their feet again. Big government helping out a smaller group to get back on their feet. Certain select groups, which could be unfair, but that's okay. So relief, recovery, and reform. Thirdly, then, to kind of change the way in which government and business operate together. Change the rules of the economy a little bit so that we won't have a future recession. Any comments about that? So the New Deal is the great outpouring of American liberalism. This belief in a bigger government that's going to try out all these new agencies to promote relief, recovery, and reform. They're all controversial. But the one that was close to Franklin's heart, because it was so unideological and it was run by his friend, Harry Hopkins, was the Works Progress Administration. Actually, the Works Progress Administration doesn't get started until 1935, but there were a bunch of agencies before that. The WPA was the most popular, and by the way, if we just sort of grab hold of these alphabetical letters, that would be enough for me. If you just say the WPA, you don't have to say the Works Progress Administration, although it may be hard to just remember letters too. But in any case, the WPA was giving out money. So if Yachts will shovel snow in Mount Pleasant, we'll give them some money for that. If Richard was willing to write a history of Mount Pleasant, Texas, let's give him some money for that. You know, something that just could kind of get people on their feet again. And Harry Hopkins says, spend, 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 elect, elect, elect. Now let's get the money out there helping these poor people, and then they will vote Democratic, and Franklin will be, you know, in for another term where he can have, you know, hand it more reform. So the WPA then is the big giveaway agency. Then we have a bunch of recovery type plans for various groups that seem particularly hard hit. And one of these, we've noted, since we looked at the populists in the late 19th century, was of course farmers. And for this, we have the AAA, the Agricultural Adjustment Act, created in this first New Deal of 1933. We recall that the populists had wanted a sub-treasury scheme so they could get low-interest loans. Now, the government's going to pay populists not to grow stuff. Isn't that a deal? The AAA shows a kind of tendency in the New Deal to war against production. 6 million baby pigs failed to reach the pure hogness of their hogdom because of the Agricultural Adjustment Act. That is, 6 million baby pigs were put to death. Now, why would they put 6 million baby pigs to death? Why would they pay farmers not to grow corn or to burn corn? Why did they pay so-called ranchers in our area to not do stuff with their land? Even today. Well, they're trying to drive up prices, basically. This mass psychology of the New Deal, which is, of the 1930s, which is still today so elusive for us to deal with. The people didn't want to buy anything. They felt kind of hung up about things. And so the government's trying to increase prices by destroying the overproduction. Of course, this does create some problems because at the same time we were destroying all these baby pigs, we were importing lard from other countries. Now, why are we doing that? Well, it's kind of complicated. Of course, if the government tries to do just like these small things, you know, over here, you're going to have another ramification of that. The question is just how huge government's going to have to be to deal with all the vertebrates at one time, and whether that would be a good one. But in any case, the New Deal does help a lot of farmers, no doubt about it. They tend to be landowners rather than sharecroppers, which is maybe another story. Likewise, we have another group that really needed help. What group had the highest unemployment? Was it Mexican Americans, German Americans, African Americans, Asian Americans? Or was it actually young people? People hired in their late teens and early 20s were last hired, first fired during the Great Depression. Their unemployment was over 60%, more than any minority. And this becomes really dangerous when they're guys. You know, the girls are okay, but the guys, they can cause all kinds of trouble. So the New Deal gets into the Civilian Conservation Corps, the CCC, and they let these guys get employed. They have like army camps, basically. Our army camp, by the way, was on Edward Street in Mount Pleasant. This is the Mount Pleasant CCC. Does anyone know what did they do with these guys? So they're getting the bunk together, they get really low pay, which they can maybe send home to their family. They're kind of like living like a military group, but they're not really military. What are these guys doing in the CCC? They build parks, basically. That's the word conservation. So we have Bob Sandlin Park, made by the CCC. That used to be a cotton plantation. I don't know if you've ever been there. You ever been there, Richard? A cotton plantation.
Oh.
Have you ever been Bob Sandlin Park, Richard? Okay. So yeah, so that old forest used to, you know, not be there, but it was, you know, set aside. Lake Dangerfield.
State Park.
Yeah, that's a beautiful park. That whole berm used to be just like a swamp, but the lake was because the CCC built that berm there. They built, in fact, 33 Texas parks. So today, you know, we can say, hey, yeah, big government did do something in Texas. And indeed, Franklin Roosevelt won handily in Texas, although a lot of people despised him in Texas. There's something they did. Is there maybe a better way to do it? Well, no one else has done it. So that does keep a lot of young people, you know, occupied. Another group that they kind of single out are the region with the really lowest per capita income, and that is not Northeast Texas. Yay! Although we're close. We have a health crisis, too, compared to the rest of the nation in Northeast Texas. But it was actually the Appalachian area,